The thrust, therefore, at the moment is two things primarily. One is we're interested in stopping the war with Syria. We're interested in undercutting, discrediting, exposing, denouncing the various covert operations which are designed to goad a reluctant and vacillating Obama, and certainly a population here in the United States that wants no part of anybody's war in Syria. No interest, no national interest, and no public interest in doing this. 70% of the U.S. population, according to the latest poll, say, don't arm those rebels. Don't give any guns or weapons to those terrorists, to those death squad characters, to those bearded crazies over there in Syria. Assad, much less of a problem for the average American than one of these Al-Qaeda-type crazies from Nusra or Farouk or whatever it is. And therefore, in that context, it's time to defeat a CIA covert operation. And the one that is now within reach of being defeated is this Ed Snowden fraud. Ed Snowden this week has moved towards a kind of merger with Assange. I suppose you can imagine Snowden and Assange nervously eyeing each other to see what the implications of competition, mutual denunciation might be from the point of view of gate receipts, numbers of world dupes, right? You can imagine both of them, Assange and Snowden, with these folders saying world dupes in mega dupes. Right, or things of this sort. But they've decided to combine, at least it's like the legend of superheroes, the legion of superheroes. They come together. However, what's very interesting, and I'm happy that Credico raised the name of Mort Saul, right, the legendary comedian Mort Saul, still alive, and I hope still fighting. This is somebody we could learn something from. When the Pentagon Papers came out, with Ellsberg and all the rest of it, there was one prominent voice that said, I don't believe this. I don't think this is really what it claims to be. And that was Mort Saul. And remember, the Pentagon Papers were doctored. They were fake. They were heavily edited. To do what? To blame Kennedy, to blame politicians, to blame the U.S. Army, to whitewash the CIA. That's simple. And, of course, nothing in there about the Kennedy assassination. And as you can read an article that I've written about this on Tarpley.net, that's gone up this week, that's exactly what we have now, right? Whistleblowers who come forward with earth-shaking revelations, and we knew it all, right? In those days, if you've been reading Agence France-Presse or Le Monde or whatever it was, you knew all that stuff. There was nothing that Ellsberg had to tell you. And similarly, today, right? You'd have to be essentially a recluse not to know that there was warrantless wiretapping and that there was Echelon and there was Operation Trailblazer and there was all this stuff back under Bush and now going on for 6, 7, 8 years. This is guy Comey, who has now been made the head of the FBI. That was his fight. Comey and Ashcroft said, we want to put a limit on the warrantless wiretapping, and that was 2004. And that came out a couple of years later, I guess, not immediately, but somewhat later. So even the left liberals are now nervous. The left liberals are hesitating. It's not a knee jerk. It's not like there's an immediate consensus of foaming support for Snowden. This is not the case. Look at the prominent left liberal Naomi Wolf. Naomi Wolf comes out on her blog saying, I am very suspicious, deeply suspicious, that this Snowden is not who he says he is. And then she follows that up with further questions. Now, the reasons that she advances are not the ones that occur to me, but they are relevant and cogent reasons. So take a look at what Naomi Wolf writes on her blog, and then you see slanderers. People coming up out of the gutter. Dave Lindorf comes up and says, is Naomi Wolf working for the National Security Agency? Well, Dave, there's only one person in this story who is documented as working for the NSA, and that's your darling Ed Snowden. There's somebody who indeed worked for the National Security Agency, right? And you know these agencies, they say you go out feet first. Once CIA, always CIA. Once NSA, always NSA. So, Dave, maybe you better go back and look at that and consider what you're doing, right? Slandering and a woman, too, right? Slandering somebody who is simply trying to, she's trying to doubt the hegemonic hysteria of the mass media. Turn on CNN. It's Snowden vision, wall to wall. And it's gotten so extreme now that the revelations are reported as if they were fact, without mentioning Snowden. In other words, you'll say, oh, there's a report now that the U.S. was spying on the participants in the G20 4 years ago in Britain. Whose report is it? And that's not mentioned, usually on radio or things like this. So Snowden has now been merged into the establishment. And as I say, the thing that is really galling about this is the goal of this is to get the Syria war. Part of it is to push all attention for the looming war with Syria to the side, right, to create this fool's atmosphere in which all the civil libertarians are they're so concerned about their own privacy that they're going to attack Obama about this. And all the while, the wheels of the war, the mobilization is going along, and the war is about to begin. And if you haven't learned anything, you've got to understand that war is the guarantee of totalitarianism. Without war, these other things can be dealt with, hopefully, or there's some chance. With war, you can forget it. There'll be hysteria. There'll be false flags. There'll be Gulf of Tonkins. So that is the actual choice. So the choice we're making here is urging people, come forward now. Denounce Snowden. Expose him. He's a fraud. This is not real. These are old headlines. This is old news, cliches, old as the hills, nothing new. The hysterical mass media, right, the Wurlitzer, has decided to recycle all this stuff as if true, as if new, and pin it all on Obama. And this simply makes no sense. Now, God knows Obama's bad enough. But what you should be doing, if you have any brains, is attacking the main warmongers of the peace. Attack Petraeus. Attack Cameron. Attack Haig. Attack Hollande. Attack Fabius. Attack General Idris, right? The new Nguyen Cao Ky out there in Syria. And as we're speaking today on the 21st of June, tomorrow there's going to be a Friends of Syria conference, right? That's part of the series. With friends like this, you don't need enemies. And I'm urging you to go forward with this because it's possible to have this thing collapse. Nothing would be better, nothing would be healthier than to have an attempted CIA limited hangout operation collapse amid general ridicule, derision, skepticism, and rejection. That is now within reach, so go to it. Avanti, as we might say. Back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio, the 21st of June here in Washington, D.C. So Snowden, this entire Snowden psyop, limited hangout psyop, is cracking, partially crumbling. A whole area of left liberal opinion represented by Naomi Wolf, the feminists, in other words, an important constituency, are highly skeptical. And we've got little fellows like Lindorf attacking with the neo-McCarthyism, right? Slanders. This is of course shameful, right? This is unworthy of anybody serious. So people over at Salon magazine on the internet, obviously wanting to defend their friend Glenn Greenwald, right? Their former associate, who has now moved on to the British intelligence organ, The Guardian, right? Left wing of MI6, we're told, or inspired by. So Salon does something about the Ed Snowden truthers. So he's got Naomi Wolf, and then he's got yours truly. I'm always flattered by so much attention. You know me, bona fama, mala fama, semper fama, as the Romans had it, right? Good fame, bad fame, it's all fame, and we're taking it. And then, of course, other Brand X commentators. One Brand X commentator says, oh, this is a fight between the NSA and the CIA. The problem with that is that just doesn't work, right? There's no such identification in the sense that Snowden has worked for both. Snowden is the CIA and the NSA. So where does that leave you? I'm afraid this kind of contorted, tortured analysis simply reflects people who are blinded by hatred of Obama, blinded by that, and also debilitated by their inability to break with this mad dog Ron Paul, Rand Paul, this combination of killer austerity, genocidal budget cuts called libertarianism. And people who have not been able to break with that, they're left with their antipathy to Obama, and then they've got to come up with some scheme that explains it in a way, well, that doesn't involve what it obviously is. It's an attack designed to weaken Obama, soften him up, and get him to the point where he'll, if not give the order for the bombing to begin, at least let the bombing begin, as Clinton did with Al Gore back in 1999, when Al Gore ordered the bombing of Serbia as Primakov was flying over the Atlantic with a peace deal. That was Clinton too weak to cancel the order, too weak to have Gore arrested, and so forth. So that's sort of where we are now. And we have a very interesting report that John Forbes Kerry of Skull and Bones, and you'll remember that when Kerry got that job at the State Department, I think I was one of the very few who put out an analysis. Remember, this is a member of Skull and Bones, just like Bush the Younger, just like Bush the Elder, just like Harriman, just like so many other villains and wreckers and monsters in recent U.S. history. That's Kerry. And the report now is that around the 12th to the 13th of June, if memory serves, there was an attempt by Kerry to start the bombing of Syria with no plan. In other words, hip shot, just send in a wave of bombers, get the bombing going, and then hopefully take it from there. Of course, the Syrian air defense is clever enough that they don't respond to individual Israeli aircraft raids. They don't even respond to small groups of cruise missiles. They will know well enough. When they see an all-out attack, they will light up their radars and they will begin to exact a considerable price. But they're obviously not going to illuminate their own radars and make themselves vulnerable in these pinprick attacks, right? That's one of the goals of the pinprick attacks, is to attempt to get the Syrian side and the Russian technicians to expose the assets that they have by turning on the radars and activating the systems. So perhaps Kerry was hoping that once he got a considerable raid in the air, then there would be countermeasures, some planes would be shot down, and then the thing would take on a life of its own. Now, the accounts differ about who stopped Kerry. Was it Obama who stopped Kerry from getting the bombing going, or was it realists in the Pentagon? That's also possible. Not everybody in the Pentagon is a Petraeus-style utopian. Remember, Petraeus has powerful enemies. He's widely hated. People that have come in contact with him call him things like brown noser, sycophant, self-promoter, all the rest, right? He does not represent a unified officer corps. That's one of the advantages of our situation, right? In clawing his way to the top, he's made lots and lots of enemies. So there are probably people in the Pentagon who don't like what Petraeus and McChrystal and so forth are proposing. So all of this is going on. Remember then that in terms of this reference to Mort Saul came out and said, I don't believe Ellsberg. He was then counterattacked by two left liberal heroes who have had glittering careers. Noam Chomsky said, oh no, Ellsberg is the real thing. I'll certify it. And then the enemy of all civilization, Howard Zinn, the exponent of Rousseau, the guy who wants to take humanity back essentially to the hunting and gathering, the Paleolithic phase. That's Howard Zinn. The two of them, Noam Chomsky, Howard Zinn, built their careers on being the yes men for the intelligence community in approving of Ellsberg. So honor to Mort Saul. And perhaps we can see today, right, the presence of Amy Wolf is kind of reminiscent of the somewhat isolated voice of Mort Saul back then. So don't let her remain isolated, right? Whatever you think of her, whatever you think about her other writings or history, that doesn't matter. Gold is where you find it. And right now, it's important for that voice and other voices who are highly skeptical of Stone to be joined, right? To be supported with, you know, obviously critical support. That, you know, there are other reasons that are more convincing to many, at least, than the ones she cites. But that also then ought to be cited. Now, concerning the issue, then, what all this is supposed to lead to? The attack on Syria. Here we have the Washington Post of today, Friday, the 21st of June. Headline story: On Syria claims criticism for the United States. Authenticity of chemical data at issue. Arms experts and envoys allege lack of transparency. And thank goodness, this is many voices in the international community saying that the so-called proof advanced by Mad Dog Kerry about the Syrian chemical weapons and Hollande and Haig and Cameron is baloney. There is no proof. There is no proof of chemical weapons. And we'll be back in a minute. All right, so the Washington Post of today, Friday, 21st of June, 2013, essentially reflects tremendous skepticism, rejection in the international community of this bill of goods from Obama and Kerry and so forth about the chemical weapons use by the Syrian regime. And perhaps the most important part of this is, well, there are a number, but the custody, chain of custody. In other words, they come and give you this material, right? Here are samples of all different things that show that chemical weapons were used. Yeah, but where does this come from? Where does it come from? And here's I think, the valid opinion. We have a certain Jean-Pascal Zanders. It's Zanders with a Z. He was formerly a research fellow at the European Union Institute for Security Studies. And he has looked at all the photographs, videos, news reports on the use of sarin nerve gas in Syria, especially those put up by the rebels accusing the regime. And he is now a skeptic. And the way he proceeded was to look at the actual well-established clinical symptoms of if you're gassed by nerve gas. That is to say, sarin gas leads to death rather quickly with blue lips and fingertips caused by suffocation and a pink hue in the complexion brought on by excessive sweating and high blood pressure. And he says, no press reports from Syria refer to those descriptions, which is one of the reasons I am skeptical about those reports. And he says that the U.S., British, and French evidence is that it cannot be tested by independent scientists. There's also this chain of custody issue. We don't have the barest information. There's not even a fact sheet documenting the samples. This is an immensely political process. There is no way of challenging the findings. So he also goes on to say, this is now a senior U.S. official, there are so many people who would like us to believe that the regime of Assad used chemical weapons. You have to question whether any of those advocates were involved in collecting the evidence. Yes, exactly. It's likely to be a big fraud. The other interesting thing here is that Erdogan of Turkey is in trouble, and he knows it now. He could be Mubarak'd at just about any point. All it would take would be a decision by the military, right? The generals that he has trampled on, that huge Turkish army, second largest in NATO, second only to the U.S., right? Formidable big military establishment. Erdogan has made his career trampling all over them, right, with good and bad reasons for doing that. If they decide that he's out, then things begin to look very, very different. So the idea now is that Erdogan has been boxed in. Erdogan is not capable of the aggression and provocations that he was planning in his nighttime conversations when Obama was whispering and cooing in his ear about his future greatness. They were planning all of these megalomaniac operations. Now looks like not so likely. So that he is afraid of inflaming the mass movement in the streets if he goes ahead and makes an attack on Syria. So in some ways, Erdogan has been paralyzed. There are some who say that he might just try a flight forward and attempt to go forward with an attack in order to perhaps, you know, try to get out of his troubles that way. But it's not so likely. And of course, remember that, you know, the Obama policy is precisely leading from behind. This interesting article says that Turkey is now also going to try to lead from behind. They want to lead from behind, too. This is a an official, this is a Turkish expert at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy. On Syria, he says, Turkey and the United States will compete in leading from behind, cautiously inching forward in involvement while allowing other countries to go further in their commitments to the rebels. So whoever takes the first step is likely to be the dupe and the loser. So maybe that will be the hysterical French and British, but hopefully some other skepticism and self-preservation will prevail there. Remember, discretion is the better part of valor, you people in London and in Paris. Don't do it. It's going to be very, very bad for whoever does it. So the other thing then is the siege of Aleppo. This is going on, right? The same edition of the New York, of the Washington Post here, has a picture of a young woman from the Popular Protection Units, and she doesn't— This is a propaganda photo, right? This is staged. It shows a young woman with no headscarf, right? She's got long hair, and it's all visible, and she's got a Kalashnikov, and she's about to shoot it. This is obviously a propaganda picture saying, look at these wonderful, the women's brigade of the Idris army. Aren't they great? Look how westernized they are. They're not wearing chadors or burqas or najabs or any of this other stuff. And it's all baloney. So tomorrow, Idris will make his plea, and he is losing, right? He's basically driven back on Aleppo, and now he is in the coils of a siege of Aleppo, and that is where the Assad forces are going, and that is where certain Hezbollah units seem to be going, and that is where perhaps even some Iranian Revolutionary Guards are going. So that is the situation. So this is all on the razor's edge, and I appeal to people, put aside your petty concern with somebody listening to your phone calls. Half the people who are concerned about this never do anything to attract any attention, right? Their main concern in life is to keep a low profile, and in that they succeed pretty well. You cannot go through life taking counsel of your fears. You cannot let everything depend on, you know, not being caught in this dragnet. Indeed, there's a school of opinion that says if you haven't attracted the attention of an oppressive power like this one, then you should really search your own conscience and ask whether you've been doing enough, right? Maybe you've been too lazy, right? Maybe you're victim of ignavia. Ignavia is the sin punished in the vestibule of Dante's Inferno. The core group are the angels who were not on the side of Christ. They were not on the side of the devil, but they were for themselves. They were the third force in the battle in heaven, right? When when Lucifer was Satan was kicked out, and all the other devils, and around them are the people who didn't follow any cause in their lives, and their punishment for all eternity is that they are forced to follow a banner, and that's all it is. It's just a banner, and they've got to run after it for all eternity because they refuse to follow any banner in their lives, good, bad, or indifferent. That is what they have to do then as their eternal punishment. So, again, right now the stars are aligned in an interesting way. Left liberal opinion is uncertain. And the thing to do is to make clear the more you indulge in your love affair with Ed Snowden, and with Assange for that matter, since they've now merged, the more you are increasing the possibility of a catastrophic general war in the Middle East with plenty of opportunity to turn into a world war. Give any guns or weapons to those terrorists, to those death squad characters, to those bearded crazies over there in Syria. Assad, much less of a problem for the average American than one of these Al-Qaeda-type crazies from Nusra or Farouk or whatever it is. And therefore, in that context, it's time to defeat a CIA covert operation. And the one that is now within reach of being defeated is this Ed Snowden fraud. Ed Snowden this week has moved towards a kind of merger with Assange. I suppose you can imagine Snowden and Assange. The thrust, therefore, at the moment is two things primarily. One is we're interested in stopping the war with Syria. We're interested in undercutting, discrediting, exposing, denouncing the various covert operations which are designed to goad a reluctant and vacillating Obama and certainly a population here in the United States that wants no part of anybody's war in Syria. No interest, no national interest, and no public interest in doing this. 70% of the U.S. population, according to the latest poll, say, don't arm those rebels. Don't nervously eyeing each other to see what the implications of competition, mutual denunciation might be from the point of view of gate receipts, numbers of world dupes, right? You can imagine both of them, Assange and Snowden, with these folders saying world dupes in mega dupes, right? Or things of this sort. But they've decided to combine, at least it's like the legend of superheroes, the legion of superheroes. They come together. However, what's very interesting, and I'm happy that Credico raised the name of Mort Saul, right? The legendary comedian Mort Saul, still alive, and I hope still fighting. This is somebody we could learn from, or Le Monde, or whatever it was. You knew all that stuff. There was nothing that Ellsberg had to tell you. And similarly, today, right? You'd have to be essentially a recluse not to know that there was warrantless wiretapping and that there was Echelon and there was Operation Trailblazer and there was all this stuff back under Bush and now going on for 6, 7, 8 years. This guy Comey, who has now been made the head of the FBI. That was his fight. Comey and Ashcroft said, we want to put a limit on the warrantless wiretapping, and that was 2004. And that came out a couple of years later, I guess, not immediately, but somewhat later. So even the left liberals are now nervous. The left liberals are hesitant from when the Pentagon Papers came out with Ellsberg and all the rest of it. There was one prominent voice that said, I don't believe this. I don't think this is really what it claims to be. And that was Mort Saul. And remember, the Pentagon Papers were doctored. They were fake. They were heavily edited. To do what? To blame Kennedy, to blame politicians, to blame the U.S. Army, to whitewash the CIA. That's simple. And, of course, nothing in there about the Kennedy assassination. And as you can read an article that I've written about this on Tarpley.net, that's gone up this week, that's exactly what we have now, right? Whistleblowers who come forward with earth-shaking revelations, and we knew it all, right? In those days, if you've been reading Agence France-Presse